I am talking about demonic barriers. Tell your neighbor.
The barriers
that are demonic shall be broken. Tell the other neighbor, the other side.
The barriers
that are demonic
shall be broken
in Jesus' name. So we talk about demonic barriers, and I will be talking about demons. I'll be talking about demons. If I were the enemy, if I was employed or given a contract to be the enemy, or to be the acting or the flag bearer of the enemy demonic kingdom, there are two things I'll ensure that I do. Number one, I'll ensure that people believe that I don't exist. Okay. Yes, I'll ensure that everybody believes that I don't exist. Why? Because I can be able to continue destroying their life, and nobody will bother to attack me because they believe I don't believe. I don't exist. I'll continue to mess them up, and they'll be visiting counselors day after day. Yet the counselors have no help to offer them, and I'll continue to thrive and to cause havoc in homes, in families, and in careers and individual lives. And number two, if I was the flag bearer of the demonic kingdom, I'll ensure that people do not understand they have authority over me. And I'll ensure that nobody will teach them that they have authority over me. Because as long as you don't know you have authority, the authority you don't know you possess, you cannot be able to use. Come on, can I have somebody talk back to me? Somebody say amen. Everyone you see, don't worry, please let nobody write you a note. Let nobody nudge you. Today we just sit down and listen to the word of God. I'll ensure, number one, that people believe I don't exist. And number two, I'll ensure that people are not taught that they have authority over me. Therefore, I would thrive, continue to mess them up. And those are the two things that I want to deal with them today. I want to deal with two things. Because there are people who believe that demons do not exist. Yet, they are causing havoc right, left, and center. There are other people who think that we are helpless. We are without power as far as demons are concerned. But thank God, you are in the right church. And you came and met the right preacher, because something powerful is about to happen today. Can I hear somebody say amen? Now, the Bible says that the entrance of your words gives light, and it gives understanding to the simple. That is Psalms 119 and verse 130. And Mark chapter 1 and verse 39, the ministry of Jesus Christ was full of rebuking demons. The ministry of Jesus Christ was a ministry of healing, was a ministry of teaching, and it was a ministry of casting out demons. The Bible says in Mark chapter 1 and verse 39, and he was preaching in their synagogues throughout all Galilee and casting out demons. You'd be surprised that even the Great Commission, one of the powers he gave us was the power to cast out demons. He said, don't begin ministry until you have the power over every demonic power, because you are going to contact them in line of duty. Can I hear somebody say amen? Amen. So, Pastor, what are demons? What are those things that people call demons? I'm glad you have asked. Demons are evil, unclean spirits that propagate satanic agendas. They are evil, unclean spirits that propagate satanic agendas. Mm-hmm. They are evil personalities without bodies, and they use bodies of men to express their nature. They are evil personalities with no bodies, and they use the bodies of men to express their nature. The evil spirit of hate, it needs a body or an emotion to express hate. So there's some people actually, today they find themselves hating on people for no apparent reason. I'm about to give you the answer. In fact, as I preach right now, if you feel some certain kind of hate rising against me, you might need a deliverance after the service. Now, if you really, because the demon of hate will require an emotion to express their hate. Have you ever experienced somebody who just hate you? People who hate you, you've never spoken to them, never done them any bad, they just hate you. Now you're understanding what I'm talking about. Let me talk to you about the nature of demons. Please just listen and be attentive today. Nature of demons. Demons are like microorganisms. What are microorganisms, Pastor? They are bacteria, they are viruses, they are fungi, they are germs. Just they call them the germs, you know? They are dirty germs. If you want to know somebody is sick, when germs enter into somebody, and I want to show you the nature of demons, when they enter into somebody, you don't see them. You can't tell they are germs. You can't see them with your naked eye. But then that person will begin to react. They'll begin to have temperature. Temperature is an indication you have a bacterial infection or you have an infection, so to say. They'll begin to have headache. They'll begin to have stomachache. They'll begin to have diarrhea. They'll begin to have this and the other. So when the doctor comes and you come to the clinic and you find a doctor, you find Dr. Andrew, he will begin to ask you, do you have a headache? First of all, he will check your temperature. He will check your blood pressure. He will check your pulse. He begin to ask you, do you have a headache? He begin to ask you, are you diarrheaing? He begin to ask you, is your family, in your family line, kuna shida kwa hiyo familia yenu? Do people have hypertension? Do they have diabetes? But guess what? When you come to the hospital, he didn't see the bacteria with naked eyes, but he can be able to see the temperature of your body changing. Are you still here, somebody? The same way with demonic spirits, you don't see them with naked eyes, but you can see them causing havoc in the lives of God's people. You can see them. You can see somebody invested with a demonic spirit. You can see somebody invested with an evil spirit in their life because they move men. You can tell this person, are you peke yake? What they're actually trying to say is that this person is possessed by a spirit. You can actually see even the way they behave, you know, somebody behaves. And let me say this, please, before you begin to throw this to your friends. All of us are prone to this. All of us, the enemy and demonic spirits, are forever trying to get into us. But I'll show you how to master them. And for where there are areas where they have taken control, today there shall be deliverance in this house in the name of Jesus Christ. Somebody shout amen. Amen. I had a story some time back of a gentleman who had a house and he decided to sell the house. And he got a buyer. When he got the buyer, he said, I'm going to sell the entire house. It's a big mansion. It has so many rooms. But I want us to have a deal. I'm going to sell the entire house except a nail at the sitting room. That nail belongs to me. Don't pick it. It is mine. But the entire house, I give it to you. And of course, the deal was sealed. And the gentleman went and occupied the house and he paid. But the nail remained with the former owner. Are you still here, somebody?
Yes, sir.
All right. And the Bible says, another Bible. The story goes like this. I love the Bible. The story goes like this. This gentleman who took over the nail, he would come and hang a rotten meat.
Yeah.
And the owner of the house,
house would ask him, what's wrong with you? This is my house. He would ask him back, what's wrong with you? This is my mail. So therefore, why are you trying to fight with me? I didn't hang in your house. I hung in my nail. The agreement of the contract is the house is yours, but the nail, come on, talk back to me. The nail is mine. And it was very tough. It was very devastating. It became so bad because when he would hang the rotten meat, the entire house would stink. The timber room would stink. The bedroom would stink. The washroom would stink. Every part of the house would stink. And I've realized, ladies and gentlemen, some of us, we have given God our lives. But there's a particular nail that the enemy is holding. It's a particular nail we've allowed the enemy to hang on. It could be the nail of alcohol. You just drink once in a while. Just once in a while. Just once in a while. Don't bother what I say. Just ignore it. Just once in a while, you take your bottle. Even some of you right now, you have beer in your fridge. So that after service, you can go back as you digest the word. As you meditate on what the man of God was preaching, you can teremusha the word. Some of us is just sex once in a while. Not much, just once in a while. Just once a month. Just once a month to cure stress. Just once a month. And that has become a nail where demonic spirits are hanging on. And the entire house is thinking. The scripture says, a little folly can destroy the entire character of a man. And some of us, it's just that one nail. And the enemy just wants a nail in your life. He doesn't want you to give you the entire house. No, give him a nail of your mind. Where he can be able to put dirty things in your mind. When you come to the house of God, lifting up your hands to worship, he begins to remind you very dirty stuff. A nail sometimes can be the phone. You know, just a phone. Some of you, if I pick your phone and go to the WhatsApp videos, the things that I'm about to see, no wonder your phone has serious pattern to open. Your pattern is like this. It has a serious pattern to open. It has a password. And you have to put a finger to sense. There's a finger sensor before your phone opens. Just in case somebody picks your phone by mistake. Today somebody will go home and delete all those videos. Because that is a nail that is causing your family to stink. Can I hear somebody say amen? Amen. Can I get a witness in the house today? Yes. JCC is a talking church. Can I get a witness in the house today?
Yes.
And demons, they just want a nail in your life. I want you to tell your neighbor, get rid of the nail. Romans chapter 6 and verse, it's going to get better today. Romans chapter 6 and verse 13, the Bible says, do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness, but rather offer yourself to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument of righteousness. Offer your mind, offer your tongue. Don't be a scanderer, don't be a gossiper. Offer your tongue, offer your eyes. Don't look at the woman with the lust. Offer your eyes. Offer your sexuality. Offer your legs. Offer your fingers. Offer your body as a living sacrifice, as an instrument of righteousness. Am I preaching right today?
Yes.
And the Bible says, don't give the enemy any foothold in your life. Let me give you the marks of a typical demonic activities. Just not your neighbor, tell your neighbor. This is your day. Marks of a typical activities of demons. And we can see that by studying the man, the madman of Gandhara. In our days, the madman of Gandhara, somewhere called Gandhara. And I don't know whether you're gonna read it for me, Gatson. Stand up, Gatson, looking so smart, full of the goodness of God, and just read the word of God. Read for me from verse 1 again.
And they came to the other side of the sea, the country of the Gandharis.
Yes.
And when he had come out of the boat, immediately they met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs.
Who had his dwellings among the tombs. Somebody say, who had his dwellings among the tombs.
And no one could bind him.
Wait a minute. Sit down and just hold the place where you've reached. He had his dwelling among where? Come on, talk back to me. He had his dwelling among where? Among the tombs. One of the things that shows you that a demonic spirit is, or an evil spirit is with somebody, is by the way we see this man had his dwelling among the tombs. He was led by demons to roam through lonely mountains and graveyards. Here, he was a man. You know why he was there? Because he was frightened. He was frightened. He was full of fear. And let me say this. Demons love to frighten their victims by fear. Through fear, the enemy is able to keep many people in bondage. And you'll be surprised how many people today who are living under fear. Through fear, the enemy is able to destroy so many dreams and so many lives. And those are demonic fear that the enemy draws in the lives of people. Pastors are full of fears nowadays. They can't even preach the glorious gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They are fearing people, fearing the opinions of people, because demons will always torment you with fear. Fear is not an attitude. It is not a mood. It is not a feeling. It is a spirit. And many people are subject to diverse fears. Fear of sickness. Fear of death. Fear of tragedy. Fear of witches, fear of the night, fear of divorce, fear of falling in love. Just hold on, I'm coming to where you are. Fear of pastors, the people who have a terrifying fear of pastors. Fear of ministry, you're called in ministry but you are in fear. Fear of disappointment, fear that you might get an accident. Fear of insects. I'm telling you right now, there's an insect that can enter this church and there shall be a revival. Fear. And of course, some of those fears are not demonic necessarily, but they are those terrifying fear. You can't even sleep. There are people who cannot even be alone in a house. They are so terrified by demons. When something hits them abati, they scream. Fear. Tell my neighbor, may God deliver you from fear. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7. Everybody say after me, for God has not given me the spirit of fear, but the spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. There are so many people today who are fearing to die. They are fearing to die. You fear death. You're fearing to die. There's even some people right now, you're fearing tomorrow. You fear life. You fear to walk. You fear to get into a train. You fear to get into a car because you're foreseeing you might get an accident. Today, in the name of Jesus Christ, I come against the spirit of fear in the name of the Lord. I declare you shall not die. You shall live to declare the oracles of God. You shall not be frightened by demons. You shall not be frightened by men. You shall not be frightened by your bosses. I declare you are delivered from fear. Amen. Can I hear somebody say amen?
Amen.
The second thing that we see in that man is that this
Demons causes men to do unnatural things. Continue reading.
While he's dwelling among the tombs,
he had his dwelling among the tombs,
and no one could bind him,
and no one could bind him,
not even with chains, because he had often been bound with shackles and chains.
Okay.
And the chains had been put apart by him.
Okay.
And the shackles broken in pieces.
Okay.
They had broken or tamed him.
Okay.
And all night and day, he was in the mountains and the tombs, crying out and cutting himself with stones.
Okay.
When he saw Jesus from Alpha, he ran and worshipped.
Wait a minute. This man, he wore no clothes. He never was living in a house, but in the tombs. And I realized that for you not to wear clothes, that's unnatural. If you see somebody walking around just the way they were born, that is not a compliment. That is unnatural. And I realized that demons causes people to do unnatural things. Somebody say unnatural things. Come on, it's a teaching, talk back to me. Somebody say unnatural things. Many people in our day are doing unnatural things. Things like, have you heard even now fathers falling in love with their daughters? Come on, talk back to me. If you're living in Kenya, you know what I'm talking about. I mean, you see unnatural things. Today we have even a website on internet on people who wants to have sexual relationships with dogs, with beasts, you know, like horses, with snakes, you know. It is a day where demons are causing people to do unnatural things. Homosexuality is an unnatural act. Because the way God created us, he created us to relate with the opposite sex. But the reason why men have been left into the mercy of their own passions is because demons causes people to do unnatural things. Unnatural things. You will see even a man cheating with a sister of their wife. It is unnatural. It is an abomination according to the culture and according to the word of God. But demons will cause you to overlook anything and do unnatural things. And some of the people here, you could be here and you're struggling with homosexuality. Necessarily, we don't hate you and we can hate you. We love you. God loves you. But you need to understand that nobody is born a homosexual. Is a demonic spirit that causes people to do unnatural things. I know I'm preaching right today. Yeah, I'm preaching right today. And every time you see men doing unnatural things, women doing unnatural things, we have even mothers nowadays who have affairs with their sons, and we have fathers having affairs with their daughters. Those are unnatural acts. And those are demonic acts, demonic power at work. And if you're here, you're having such an unnatural tendency, today, Jesus will deliver you in the name of Jesus Christ. Jesus does not condemn you, but he will deliver you and clean you up because he has a glorious destiny for you. Can I hear somebody say amen? Amen. Number three, he was mentally and emotionally tormented. This man was mentally and emotionally tormented. He was what? He was mentally and emotionally tormented. This man of Gandhara, he was in the tubes crying. Can you imagine a man just seated in the tubes crying? And I've realized that demons torment people's mind. They torment people's mind with unbelief, doubt, forgetfulness, confusion, bad dreams. They harass people by frequent attacks on their minds through negative thoughts. He was emotionally and mentally tormented. Dirty thoughts. Evil spirits, they have an assignment to stop people of God from getting into the Holy of Holies. They harass. And others are tormented mentally. This man was tormented. He used to cry. He was a sad man. Others are tormented with resentment, with hatred, with uncontrolled anger. There are people today, when you get angry, people can be talking well and laughing in the house, but when you get angry, I mean, it's like something gets into you. Yeah. You break the glass. You bang the door. You kill the cat. I mean, it's that bad. It's that bad. When you get angry, nobody can talk to you.
When you get angry, you are a terror. And let me tell you something. If you check yourself, it is something that gets into you. It's called the spirit of anger. It's an evil, demonic spirit of anger. And that demonic spirit of anger will destroy your marriage. It will destroy your relationship. Some of the young people today who are not married, they are in their fourth relationship. Yeah. And all of them, they called quit. Out of anger. Yeah. It is over. And you're wondering, no, I just came late. And I explained to you, it was my mom who was unwell, you know, and I came late. I said, no, you're not serious. It is over. Until you destroy that spirit of anger, you're going to be single until your father notices. Somebody say, in the name of Jesus, this is my day of deliverance. Can I get a witness in the house? Say, in the name of Jesus, this is my day of deliverance. This man was sad. He was depressed. He was emotionally depressed. And today, a lot of people today are experiencing evil sorrow. If Satan had his way, you'd be crying every day. Crying every day. Yeah. Sadness. There are people, even today, they are married to their wives. I had a man who was telling me, I don't know what's wrong with my wife. Because sometimes we are on the sofa, laughing, having a good time, watching television. And then I just turn to her and she's crying. And wondering what happened? What happened to her? Sweetie, what's wrong? Nothing. Because now when he asks, now it becomes even the baby. Nothing, sweet. Now, and you're wondering what's wrong. It's called a spirit of sorrow. It's a spirit of, and some of you right now, the entire night before you came to church, you just crying. Even right now as I'm preaching, you feel like crying. It's a spirit of sorrow. You feel broken. You can't even tell. Is there anybody who knows what I'm talking about? Yes. Do you have friends like that? Yes. Amen. Even if you are the one, just say, I have a friend like that one. It's a spirit of sorrow, sadness, heaviness, discouragement. Some people just wake up in the morning and you feel discouraged. Nobody has cursed you. You have paid your arrears. You don't have any rent arrears. Your son is okay. You have the money, but you're just discouraged. It's an attack from the pit of hell. But I came to let you know, the Bible says that you will show me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. Let me say this, ladies and gentlemen. God is not the source of your sorrow. God is not the source of your disappointment. Our God is a God of joy. I don't know who I'm talking to right now. He is a God of joy. When God comes into your life, you get happy. When God comes into your life, you are excited. You wake up in the morning every day with a splint on your leg because you are excited about God. Sorrow is demonic. Disappointments are demonic. Erratic crying is because the enemy is trying to attack you. But I hear the Lord says today, He will take away every spirit of heaviness and give you a garment of praise. I say He will give you a garment of praise. Somebody say amen. Amen. For in the presence of God, there's fullness of what?
Joy.
Somebody shout joy.
Joy.
Somebody shout a better joy.
Joy.